This morning, I'm going to wait until after the sermon to honor our graduates, and there's a reason why. Because this morning, I want to just preach to you specifically, but the good news is every message out of the Word of God can apply. Amen? It's amazing. I've seen preachers preach on one of the most cringe topics in the Bible to most church people, which is tithing. And seeing people come to know Christ in a message about tithing. I mean, I've never imagined that somebody would become a believer in Christ because of a preaching message on tithing. But I've seen it happen. And so I found that God can speak in any way. And so no matter what stage of life you're in this morning, this message is going to encourage you. But just notice that there's going to be times when I specifically speak to the graduating class of 2018. Amen. As we try to honor them and challenge them this morning through God's Word. And so, without further ado, we're out of Ruth, so we can skip that screen. But let's go to Joshua chapter number 1 and verse number 9. And the Bible says, "Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed or discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Amen. Yes. "Or whithersoever thou goest," is the King James version of that. Amen. Let's pray this morning and ask God's blessing on the service. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to stand and preach your word one more time. God, we don't take it for granted this morning, and we thank you, Lord, that you've given us a stage and a platform to stand on and an audience to speak to. And God, I believe, Holy Spirit, that you've prepared the hearts and minds of these people this week for exactly what you have for them today. Lord, whether they're here with us in body, or whether they're watching over the internet this morning, or whether they'll watch it later this week sometime, God, I believe that you're going to use your word, because you said that it would not return to you void. God, it's not about me this morning. It's not about any specific individual in this place. But God, it's all about you, Jesus. And we want to lift you up this morning, because you said in your word that you would draw all of us closer to you if we did lift you up. And so, Lord, this morning, as we lift you high, as we elevate the name of Jesus, we pray that you would transform lives, Holy Spirit, as only you can. Lord, we love you. We thank you. Help us to see what it is in the word today that you want us to hear. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. I remember back to when I graduated. I had had plans after my graduation that I had already signed the paperwork and everything, and roughly a month after my graduation, I was to be on a plane for the first time in my life from Charlotte to Atlanta, Georgia, then a little commuter plane from Atlanta to Fort Benning, Georgia. Amen. To go into the military, to go in there and do what I thought at the time, well, actually what I knew at the time, I wanted to do. Amen. It was my goals and my dreams and my life. And honestly, I didn't consult with God about any of it, because I wasn't living like I should at the time. And so I graduated, went to the beach for a vacation, came home, spent a week or two, and then jumped on a plane and took off. And as they say, the rest is history. Amen. Learned a lot of valuable lessons while I was there, but I found very quickly I was in the military for just a matter of about 3 or 4 months to get through all the training, and then I got a discharge, an honorable discharge, due to medical reasons that they said happened before I went in the military, that I could not do what I planned to do. And so again, doing what I wanted to do, and this was God's way of getting me home so I could meet my awesome wife, but doing what God wanted to have done in my life, he made it where I had a way that I could not go and do what I chose to do and get home. Amen. So my plans got changed very quickly, is what I'm trying to say. And I had to adapt to what was happening in my life. And so I know that many of you graduating in 2018 have the course laid out in your mind, but I just want to encourage you this morning, not discourage, don't be dismayed, but encourage you that if the plan changes at the last minute, if God intervenes and something doesn't work out and that door closes, realize the Bible says this in Revelation: the door God opens, he nor no man can close. Amen. He will leave it open. and nobody can close it. The door God closes, no man can open. And so realize that there's doors that God is going to open in your life, and there's doors that he's going to close in your life, but just trust the process. And we find that in our story this morning. Because what we find in Joshua chapter 1 is a new leader emerging on the scene for the nation of Israel and the Hebrew children. What we find here is in verse 1, if you have your Bibles, I'm going to read the first 9 verses and talk to you a little bit from those verses this morning. And I hope that this will encourage you, because what I find is maybe there's people here this morning that is in a job transition. Maybe you're in here this morning and you're in a time in your life like you've never seen before. Maybe you're here this morning and you're in a position where you're looking and you think you found that special somebody, or you're a new parent. We go through all these phases in life that are, and honestly, graduate. Amen. We graduate from childhood to the teen years, and then from the teen years to those years of young adulthood and college life and all that stuff, and then from young adulthood to usually most people being a little more responsible, going into marriage maybe, and then having children, and then later on in life just continually moving up, whether it be a career or life, to a new level. So that's kind of what graduation is about, moving to a new level. And the final graduation we find is the culminating factor of when we graduate from this life to glory. Amen? And that's the final graduation when we go to be with our Lord. But the Bible says in Joshua 1, now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord. I'm going to stop there, because that's important. Realize for the last 40 years of Moses' life, he has been the leader of this congregation of Hebrew children, taking them to what is supposed to be their destination. But because of their rebellious attitude, they do not get to go into the land of Canaan that God has promised. And therefore, they wander for 40 years, and Moses is leading them. Even though they constantly speak against Moses, and they constantly don't want to agree with what Moses is doing and what God is leading him to do, they honor Moses. They love Moses. They have a respect for Moses, even though they're not following him. Amen? It's funny that they respect him, but they won't go in his leading. Amen? But the important thing about this is this story is about Joshua. And so, people, this morning, I want you to understand and put yourself in Joshua's shoes. You've been serving as a minister, as a helper to Moses. Amen? You've been learning under his tutelage. You've been learning from him. You've been experiencing some of the things he's experienced. You've been there with him. He's been training you for a day, just like many of you have been in school learning under people who have went before you, who have led the field in your career choices, who leads the field at your workplace, who your parents who's led the way. But notice now Moses is dead. Now, the Bible doesn't clearly speak that I found, other than God speaking to Joshua here, how that the people even knew Moses was dead. Because if you know the story of Moses, God tells Moses, look, I'm not going to let you go into Canaan land because of some things you've done, but I'm going to let you see into it. So go up on this mountain apart, all by yourself, look over, I'm going to show you everything that you didn't get to go into. And he said, but therefore, even with that, I'm going to bury you myself, because I realize how these people are, and they're quick to idol worship. And if I let you bury, if I let them bury you, if I let them know you've died, then they'll make idols to you, is basically what I believe God is saying. He's saying they'll start worshiping you because you was the greatest man they've ever known. They believe you brought them out of bondage, I brought them out of bondage. Amen? And so we don't want them to be worshiping any human being. I'm the only one that deserves worship. So God, and the Bible says in Deuteronomy that Moses was 120 years old, but his eyes had not dimmed. In other words, Moses is in good health. He's not like the 120-year-olds we think of today. Moses was still vibrant. He was still in good health. He still saw very clearly. If he didn't see, how did he see all the way across that land of Canaan? Amen. He still saw clearly. He heard clearly. He was a strong man. He was in good shape. And so the thing is, he didn't die because he was old and worn out. He died because God said, I'm finished with your work. It's time for you to go on. Somebody else is getting ready to step in. Isn't it good this morning to know that God has prepared us just take over where others are going to leave off. It's encouraging this morning to know that. As parents, we take over where our parents left off, and we try to do better with our kids. No offense to our parents or their parents, but I believe most good parents try to have better for their kids than they have. Amen? We want to see their kids achieve more than they achieve. And so the thing is that we try to do better. And I hope my kids take that and go with the torch and say, when I have children, I want them to do more than I did. I want them to do better than Grandpa did. Amen? I want them to be achievers and believers in what God can do. But we find Moses has died, and the Lord spoke to Joshua, the son of Nun. So imagine Joshua. All he knows is Moses has gone away. They're expecting Moses to come back. Moses hasn't returned. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit speaks, or God speaks to Joshua and says, hey, Joshua, guess what? Moses is dead. Can you imagine the pressure? The pressure Joshua was feeling. I don't know that Joshua really understood until this moment that he was really the guy. God speaks to Joshua and he says, hey, listen, Moses is dead. But don't worry. When I put you in your mother's womb, I put you in there and prepared you for this moment. Amen? You see, it's good and it's encouraging to know that nothing has taken God by surprise, class of 2018. Nothing in your life, church family, is going to take God by surprise. No matter what life throws at you. No matter what comes around the corner, no matter what peeks its head up in the night, God knew before the foundations of this world exactly where you would be right here, right now. Amen? He knew what phase of life you would be in. He knows the end before the beginning. He knows the end of your story. That encourages me because some days I feel like such a mess up. I wonder, why is God even wasting time with me? But then I remember, and the Holy Spirit reminds me, it's because I've seen the end of your life, and I know what's going to be achieved in the end, and all you're looking at is the now. Amen? And so it encourages me to know that there must be something going to happen good in this mess of my life because God is still taking time to work with me. Amen. I'm the pottery on the potter's wheel that he's not throwing away. He's working with me and molding me and shaping me. And so this morning as we look forward to the future, we must know that God is speaking to us saying, listen, I have a purpose for your life this morning. I have a destiny that I am trying to take you to, and it's not just for you, it's for other people around you. Realize the children of Israel, God came down from a cloud and spoke to them and said, oh, my nation, just walk across the border and it's yours. Amen? But he didn't do that. He said, every people needs a leader, and Joshua, you're the guy. Yeah. And so he comes and he speaks to Joshua, the son of Nun, and this is what he says. He says, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now get up and go over to Jordan. Now this is funny because I'm sure Joshua was thinking, well, for the last 40 years, Moses has had no success getting these people here, God. Moses is dead. Do you know the revere and the respect these people have for Moses? How do I prove he's dead? I'm putting myself in Joshua's shoes. How do I prove he's dead? Can I take him and show him his body? Are they going to think this is a coup for leadership? That I want to be the great leader of the nation of Israel? I mean, hey, I know I'm one of the two spies that believed your report, that believed we could have Canaan, me and Caleb, but hey, I mean, why not Caleb? Why me? Why are you choosing me? Because God has a special purpose for Joshua. He knows that deeply ingrained in Joshua is something that is not ingrained in other people. The fields that we follow God into in our careers, if we let God lead, I told you I did not let God lead in the original. Maybe I did and didn't know it. Maybe he had some things I needed to learn. But I can tell you this, I didn't spend time on my knees saying, God, do you want me to go to the military or not? But maybe in his providential will, he did send me there to teach me some things. I don't know. But either way, I know that if we let God lead, God will lead us to the place he wants us to be, where he can use us most effectively to be involved in his work and what he is doing. And Joshua is here. Joshua is here, and he's already been into Canaan. He's already seen what Canaan has to offer. He came back and said, I believe God wants to give me greater than what we've had. I believe he wants to bless us. Now realize, when they come out of Egypt, they're rich, man. They come out with wealth. They've come out with material goods. They're not hurt. Amen. But somewhere along the way, they forgot food. And so they're in this barren wasteland. And for 40 years, God has clothed them. God has fed them. God has given them water. God has taken care of them. He's given them shade by day, fire by night. I mean, who could ask for more than what God is doing? And I believe you'll find that even in the desolate times where you're wandering through life, that God is taking care of you too. When you didn't even realize how to take care of yourself, God was still providentially watching over your life and taking care of you, meeting your every need. I know what the Bible says in Matthew 6, that if we put first the kingdom of God and all his righteousness, everything we need will be added. But thank God for grace in the days when I didn't put God first and I still had his blessings on my life. Amen. And so this morning we find that Joshua is being told to get up, go over to Jordan, him and all the people, unto the land which he gave to them, even the children of Israel. He says, I'm going to give you something that you've never been given before. Some of you are getting ready to go into new jobs. It's a scary situation. Amen? Some of you are getting ready to promote in your business. It's a scary situation. Some of you are dealing with health issues and life issues that are a scary situation. It's very stressful. It's very hard to deal with sometimes. But God is sitting here telling us this morning, imagine Joshua. Imagine the stress on this man. He's going to lead millions of Israelites into Canaan land and establish the kingdom of God there and take over. And he says, hey, you're going to have to do it because Moses has died. You are the one I've chosen for this time, for this place, to go and be a blessing to other people. And so realize this morning, no matter how much stress you're under, I can almost promise you it's nothing compared to the stress Joshua was under. And by the way, the name Joshua is equivalent to Jesus in the Old Testament, the name meaning Savior. Amen. So here we have a picture of Jesus, if you will. I believe that when God led Jesus into the wilderness for those 40 days and 40 nights, attributing to testing, I believe that God was showing Jesus, you are the chosen. You're the one that I have chosen to lead the world out of where they've been into the place where I promised them. And so what we find this morning is, he says, Moses, my servant, is dead. In verse 2, I want you to go to this place. And then look what he says in verse 3. This is encouraging this morning, church, because he says, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread. In other words, this is the soul in every place it steps. He says, I'm going to give it to you. Every place that your foot goes, I'm going to declare it yours. I'm deeding it to you. So in other words, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine. In other words, I believe what God wants to help you with this morning is that he's saying, everywhere you step into that I've led you, it's already yours before you get there. The deed is already made. Amen. Isn't that encouraging this morning? That God says, that new job that I opened the door for, I opened it so you can already count it. It's yours. All you got to do is walk through the door. Amen. He said, hey, that healing that I've got for you, it's yours. I just need you to walk. Remember what Jesus said to the lame man? He said, take up your bed and walk. In other words, let your foot walk on it, and that's faith that you believe in. Amen. Follow me. Walk by faith, not by sight. It's easy to walk by sight when everything's right in front of you and it's laid out and you know. Wouldn't it be awesome just to know how every week and every year and every month and every decade is going to go? In some instances, it would be great to know the future. Sometimes, amen, at least on the good side of things, it'd be great to know what's coming around the bend or what's going to happen 10 years from now, where I'm going to be. I mean, I've got my goal, Lord, but what's it really going to look like so that I know how to adjust my life? Well, that's not faith. And Joshua is being told here, I want you to walk by faith and know that everywhere your foot goes, I've already given it to you. Amen. And if you know the story of Joshua, he gets to the walls of Jericho. He doesn't know what to do. He's in prayer talking to God. Jesus, pre-incarnate, shows up. And there he is, and he says, hey, are you for me or against me? And he says, I'm for the Lord.
Just follow me. Amen.
Do what I tell you to do. Walk around the city. Around the city, yes. 7 times. In other words, everywhere your foot walks, I'm going to give it to you. But I want to see if you trust me. So don't say a word. Walk around it 7 times for 7 days. And on the 7th day, on the 7th time, have the trumpets blow, have the priest shout, have the people shout, and it's yours. Amen. Why? Because everywhere your foot goes, it's yours. And then you find when they get in the city, it's theirs. They conquer. Amen. Everywhere your foot goes by faith, I'll give it to you. So this morning, walk in faith. Walk in faith in the word God is leading you. Trust Him in the process. Trust Him that He's going to give you everything that He has set aside for you. He has promises that He's already declared in heaven before you were created over your life. He has already declared and decreed things that He wants to bring to pass in your life, but He's waiting on you to take action and walk in. You know, a lot of restrooms today have the light systems where they shut themselves off and shut themselves on when you go inside the door. I don't know if you've ever been in there and had to be in there for a moment and all of a sudden the light go out. Amen. Thank God for smartphones and you flash your light on. Amen. But the thing is that you're in there and as soon as you walk through the door, the light comes on. When there's no movement, the light goes off. What are you saying? I'm saying the light is kind of like faith. When you move, it shines. Amen. And what God is waiting is for you to move so the light can come on, so that He can guide you in the steps that He has for your life. So walk in faith and not by sight. And so we find that God tells him here, I'm going to give you every place your foot goes. I'm going to give you everything. Look what he says. He basically says, let me just summarize, everything in the land of Canaan is yours. From border to border, from invisible line to invisible line, everything I decreed to your forefather Abraham is yours. Isn't it amazing that many years have passed and God is such a promise-keeping God that he says, there's been so many failures and so many falls and so many fumbles along this path, I'm still going to be faithful. And Joshua, you're going to be the guy that I'm going to use to bring this group of people that have been rebellious and stiff-necked into their promise. That encourages me this morning. To know that after all the years of refusal, they're fixing to get into the land of promise. It's not going to be easy, though. Because look at what he says in verse number 5. And this is where I really want to start concentrating. He tells Joshua, because see, he knows Joshua. He knows what Joshua's thoughts are. Maybe there's conversation that's not recorded for our benefit here this morning. But the thing is that here's Joshua. He's hearing all this. But imagine some of the controversy Joshua has to feel. Again, Moses hasn't been able to accomplish this in 40 years. He could bring them out of Egypt, but he couldn't get Egypt out of him. And so he's like, you know, God, it's not that I don't believe you. It's just these people. I mean, Moses believed you, but look. Now you're telling me he's dead. And the last time I saw him, he was slapping a rock 3 or 4 times, getting frustrated with the people. And now he's dead? I mean, that's kind of intimidating. I don't want to die. I mean, imagine. And the reason I can say that is because the next phrase we hear out of God's mouth to Joshua is a phrase of encouragement. And he says here in verse 5, don't worry, Joshua. No man will be able to stand before you all the days of your life. Nobody can stop you from what I've got for you. That's awesome. Because I don't know about you, but I've seen a lot of people in my life that would love to thwart what God has for me. And I actually have moments in my life that I believe that I or somebody else can actually postpone or stop what God wanted to do. But I've read in the Bible somewhere that it says God's purpose can't be thwarted. What God wants to do, He's going to accomplish. Amen? Now, I can choose not to let him accomplish it through me. That is definite. Amen. I can choose that. He will not force me to do anything. But he didn't say, Joshua, you can't stop it. He said, you don't need to worry about the Hittites, the Malachites, the Amorites, the Jebusites. You don't need to worry about nobody else. You don't need to worry about no giants. You don't need to worry about nobody, because nothing or nobody can stand in front of where I'm taking you. Now that's encouraging. Especially after you've been walking around for 40 years in a circle. This is real encouraging, because all of a sudden he says, this is the time for your breakthrough. Listen to what he says. As I was with Moses, he says, look at those that I've already dealt with before you. I will be with you. I will not fail you. I will not forsake you. That sounds like Jesus. Jesus said, don't worry, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll be closer than a brother. God tells Joshua here, listen, don't worry. I'm going to be with you. I'm going to stick with you. I'm going to go through this with you. I'll never leave you. I'll never abandon you. I'll never forsake you. If you need me, whisper my name and I will be there. I will show up in the midnight hour. I will show up in your worst debate and debauchery of life. I will show up when you are destroyed, it seems. I will show up when you are detested. I will deliver you out of the hand of the enemy. Nobody can stand against you, Joshua. I have got your back. If you remember Moses going across the Red Sea, I'll bring you across anything that I need to bring you across. I do not want you to go into this fearful and afraid. I am with you. Can I tell you this? The Bible says, if God be for you, who can be against you? If you know that God is on your side this morning, if you believe that Jesus Christ loved you enough to die for you and get up from the dead for you, then what else won't he do for you? I mean, he's died for you. Do you think he won't fight for you? Do you think he won't deliver you? He's already delivered you. The problem is we allow the situation to become so overwhelming that we feel like there's no way that this is achievable for me. That's the thing that I want you to understand. Don't get so independent. Don't get so intelligent that you don't think you need God. Because without God, you can do nothing. But with God, you can do anything. And so the problem is this morning is that many times we think, okay, I'm here. I've reached this level of my life. I've graduated to this plateau, and I'm good. I'm good. I don't need him anymore. He got me past the test. He got me past the schooling. He got me past the interview process. He got me through the pregnancy. He got me through the engagement. He got me through this. He got me through that. I'm good. I don't need him anymore. We're good. But I'm telling you, you're going to need him. And you're going to need to lean on him through this time of your life, because God wants to take you into a new plane. He's got something greater than where you are now. You've been serving. You've been a servant. But he says, I'm going to take you and make you from a servant to a leader. And you're going to help people. You're going to save people. You're going to deliver people. And so what we find this morning is here he is. And he says, I'll not fail you and I'll forsake you. Look what he says in verse 6. Be strong. In other words, Joshua's feeling weak. Why would you tell somebody to be strong? I remember when before I went into, jumped on that airplane to Atlanta and then to Columbus, Georgia. I remember that I felt pretty strong until they put me on a cattle bus and with 55 other men crammed in there like this, and drill sergeants running on every open entrance on the bus, screaming down your throat. I felt like I was pretty weak. I was scared. I was terrified. I'm just trying to be honest with you. I didn't feel good at that moment. I was really just wanting to curl up in a fetal position, suck my thumb, and call my mom. Amen. I was like, what did you do? What are you doing, you idiot? What did you choose to do this for? I mean, you chose to do this. They didn't drag you here. You chose this. You're an idiot. And that's the way a lot of you are going to feel when you start to step into this. I believe that's the way Joshua felt. I believe he was saying, God, just resurrect Moses, bring him back. I mean, God, I'm really not the God for this. And God says, be strong. Be strong. Now, where is our strength really found? In God. Because we realize God is strength. God is the strongest of all things that we could ever know. When we are feeling weak, the Bible says in our weakness, He is made strong. It's amazing that God will use the weak things of this world to confound the wise. It's amazing that God will use people that shouldn't be where they're at. They're unqualified, if you will. But He will qualify them and equip them. And He will enable them and empower them. And He will educate them. And He'll bring them to the level they need to be. I think it's awesome that the fishermen, who really didn't have a lot of knowledge other than fishing, when they stood before kings, they amazed the kings. And the king said, "These men have been with Jesus." Amen. Isn't it good to know that when you go out into this world, when you go into the next phase of your life, no matter where you're at, that people can look at you and they're going to say, they've got something we don't have. They're on a level we're not on. We went to a better school, but how are they achieving more than we achieve? It's because when God is on your side. Amen. Amen. Realize Romans 8:28, for He's working for you. He's working in ways you don't even understand. He's pulling strings behind the curtain you can't even see. He's swinging open windows and opening doors and positions and places of work. He's doing all these things. He's bringing up one side of the mountain, the ram that's going to be caught in the thicket for you. In other words, you're walking up this mountain thinking, I don't see my deliverance, when the whole time He's bringing your answer up the other side. He's got what you need. You just got to trust Him and walk and believe in faith where He leads. And so what we find is He says, be strong and be very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant has commanded you. Turn you not from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. The book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate on the law or the word of God day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in the word. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. Now listen, if I ask any of you this morning, no matter what stage of life you're at, would you like to be prosperous, successful, for the kingdom of God? I believe we'd all have to raise our hand and say, yes, Lord, let that be me. I mean, I don't want to just plunder through it. I want to prosper in it. I want to be prosperous for your kingdom, for your will, for your name. I want to do something that's going to leave a legacy behind. It's going to make a difference. God says, let me tell you how to do that. And I want you to listen closely. How do I do that? How do I know for sure I'm going to succeed in what I'm going into, Pastor? How do I know that I'm going to succeed in being a new mom? How do I know I'm going to succeed in being a new dad? How do I know I'm going to succeed in this new career choice? How do I know I'm going to succeed in my recovery process, in my rehabilitation, in my conquering of my addictions and my sins and my temptations? How do I know I'm going to succeed in my ministry? How do I know I'm going to succeed on my job? How do I know I'm going to succeed in my career, in my choice of college? How do I know these things? Let me tell you how you know. Number one, be strong and be courageous. Number two, follow God where He leads. Number three, just do what the Bible says. It's easy to get so caught up in the textbook that you forget about His book. It's easy to get so caught up in Facebook that you forget about His book. Amen? I seen a kind of funny post yesterday on Facebook for the few minutes I was on there. And I was scrolling through and I seen this picture of these two burnt steaks, and it said, recipe for burnt steak. It said, you know, take your steaks out, let them marinate, season them, put them on the oven or put them on the grill, and then get on Facebook. I was like, yeah, that's so many people. I mean, this past week when I was on the coast, it amazed me. People taking their phones out of the ocean. I was like, are you kidding me? It's like it's attached. It needs to be surgically removed. You're taking your phone in the ocean. In the pool. And then the girl complains because she gets it wet. And they're like, take your stupid, our parents say, take your stupid phone out of the pool if you don't want it wet. You know? Like, people, come on. But isn't it amazing? We'll dedicate our lives to so much stuff. Let me help you. Don't forget who got you here. I mean, I remember when I got off that bus, I was doing praying for the first time in a long time. And I was like, God, help me. I don't know what I've got myself into, but help me through this every morning. God, help me to be able to do this PT. God, help me to do this. Help me. I wasn't living right, but I was still calling on him. God, help me. And I'm going to tell you something. Even in my worst time, I never forgot who got me to where I was. And this morning, I want to encourage you, don't forget. I don't care if you're 100 years old sitting here this morning. God brought you to this moment. Without him, you wouldn't be alive. Without him, you wouldn't be here. So don't forget to go to him as your God. That's why we have so many detours in life, because we forget to go to God and say, hey, what is your words? You see, God speaks to us in several ways, through people, through the Holy Spirit, through circumstances, and through his word. And most of us don't hear his voice, and we wonder, why am I not hearing God? Because we're not in the book. He's written out the instructions. You mean he's going to tell me, Jody, this is where I want you to go? No, not in those words, but the Holy Spirit used Joshua to speak to me and say, Jody, I want you to do this. I want you to do that. And so he uses his word to speak to us. And so we find this morning here that he says that I want you to prosper. I don't want you to turn to the right hand or to the left, but turn to me. Don't let the word of God depart from your mouth. Recite it, rehearse it, memorize it, know the word of God, and observe what is written therein, and you will, without a doubt, 100% be prosperous. That's what he says. Have not I commanded you, our last verse, have not I commanded you, be strong and of good courage. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. We find that there's a trinity of a statement here. There's a three-peat. In these nine verses, there's a phrase repeated three times. Be strong and of good courage. Which makes me believe Joshua is really struggling with courage and strength right now. He's feeling weak, he's feeling vulnerable, and he's feeling very afraid. For one, he's got to go tell people that he's being called to do something. Then how does he make them believe it? For two, he's getting ready to take on the most important and largest responsibility of his known life. Leading a group of people into the promises of God. You say, well, that's not quite my field. That's not quite what I'm doing. You probably are without even realizing. Because God wants glory in every facet of your life, including your workforce, your family life, whatever you choose, whatever God leads you to do, he wants glory in it. He wants to show himself through you. And so this morning, realize that as we step and we walk in faith, and God is giving us everywhere our foot treads, and we're realizing we're going behind great people who went before us, whether they be family or work-related, career-oriented, whatever. They went before us. They've trailblazed. We have to pick up where they left off. We have to go forward and do greater things. And the whole time, we're just trying to get people to the place God has for them. That's what we're trying to do, is bring people into the place God has for them, realizing that while we're doing that, God is bringing us to the place he has for us. And every promise that he made over your life, he intends to keep as long as we'll just obey. Now, in that obedience, we have a choice. We can choose to go into it and plunder through life, just kind of staggering like a baby learning his steps, or we can choose to hold to the hand of the master and just follow him wherever he leads, and just be like sheep obeying the shepherd's voice and go wherever it leads and say, oh, I was planning on going left, but if you say go right, let's go right. I want to go wherever you lead, God, because I know that is where I'm going to prosper. And so you follow him, and you go with him, and you let him guide you. And as he does, he begins to grant to you the promises that he made. And the whole time, there's going to be moments. There's going to be days. Shoot, there might even be a year that you feel so much apprehension and so much stress and so much turmoil from the situation. Realize it wasn't easy. I don't want to give you a false impression that Joshua just walked in and said, hey, guys, I'm here. It's mine. Because God could have wiped out every enemy and then just walked through, but God didn't do that. He said, I want to see how bad you want it, how much you believe in it, fight for it.
They had to fight at Jericho. They had to fight themselves when Achan took stuff from Jericho that he wasn't supposed to take, and then they lost little battles when they should have won them. They had to continue to listen to God and obey God, and Joshua was leading this bunch of misfits into the promised land. And then when they get there, they fight the greatest battle of taking over against these huge giants compared to them. But Joshua just will not give up on what God has said. And God has said, I'll be with you. I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'm going to prosper you. I'm going to bless you. I'm going to use you for greatness. Just follow me. And this morning, I believe that was the message for every single person in this place. God has great things ahead for you in the coming days, in the coming months, in the coming years. But he says, I want you to follow me. I want you to go with me. I want you to go when it's hard. When it's so hard you can't get up in the morning, I want you to get up believing that tomorrow is going to be better. Weeping may endure for the night, but joy will come in the morning. I want you just to trust me in the process, because the process is where you're going to prosper. When you get through the process, at the end of it, you will be prosperous. This morning, this is your promise from God. This morning, graduating class of 2018, I don't want you to be afraid. I don't want you to go into life scared to death. I don't want you to go into life feeling like I can't accomplish this. You can do everything God has set out for you to do if you'll trust Him and lean on Him and just go in the process with Him. Let Him guide you. Let Him lead you. I don't care what phase of life you're in. Go with God this morning and watch God move in your life. Amen? As they play me something from the sound booth this morning, let's bow our heads for just a minute. And this morning, I want to ask you, no matter where you're at in life, because I've talked to many of you, and I know you're doing career changes, and some of you are in the process of new families, and some of you are in the process of struggles in your physical being, and maybe even in your family right now. Some of you are just going through major decision-making processes, trying to get to a next level with God. This morning, maybe it's the career you're involved in already. God's put you in a leadership position. When you started, you really didn't think you'd be in the position you are now, but He's there. Maybe it's that God has changed the course that you thought you were taking. And that place that you thought you were going has died. And now there's a new opening. And He says, if you'll just follow me, it's going to be a fight. Every day is not going to be easy. I have something great in store for you. And I want to bless you. I want you to leave behind a legacy. They'll talk about what I did through you for years to come. This morning, God's looking for some people to step out in faith, which is hard to do. It causes fear sometimes, but remember, fear is a lie. Faith is always true. And so step out in faith with God this morning. Just be honest enough this morning to say, Pastor, you know, I'm going through some stuff that have apprehensions. I don't feel qualified. I'm struggling. I'm stressed. I'm scared. And God knows all this about me already. And I just want to pray that He'll be with me through this, and that I can hear His voice, and that He'll guide me, and He'll take me to where He wants me to be, because I know in the end, then it'll be better for me to be there than where I thought I needed to be. So, Pastor, I'm going to raise my hand in faith and ask you to pray for me. Would anybody do that this morning? Raise your hand and say, please pray for me. I see that hand. Anybody else, raise your hand and say, please pray for me, that I can just follow God in this process of life. And then I see that hand. And then He'll take me. I see Him. But He'll take me to where I'm supposed to be. I see those hands. Anybody else this morning? I see that hand. Anybody else? I see that. Anybody else this morning? As we stand to our feet this morning, I want to ask you to take it one step further. You see, Joshua hadn't had the conversation with the Lord Himself. And I believe this morning God has blessed us with the opportunity to be in a cool building and a carpeted area here at the front, that you personally can come and talk to your Creator. And you can kneel before Him or sit before Him. And you can talk to Him and you can say, God, help me. to overcome my fears. Help me to overcome these apprehensions. Everything I raise my hand about, God, I need your help with right now, because I'll be honest, Jody can't help you a lot, but Jesus can help you all the way. And so this morning, as this altar is open, if you raised your hand, why don't you come? Why don't you come and have that one-on-one conversation with God right now? Some are moving. Why don't you move with them in faith? Everywhere your foot goes, he's going to give you. So he's waiting on your foot to walk in it. He's waiting on your foot to say, it's mine, God. I'm coming after it. I'm going to believe you for it. I'm going to walk to it. I'm going to trust you in the process. I'm going to trust you for the prosperous journey. I'm going to trust you that when I'm fighting, you'll protect me. I'm going to trust you that when I'm needy, you'll provide for me. I'm going to trust you that when I feel independent, you'll help me to realize I'm interdependent upon you. I'm going to trust you that I just need you, God. I need you to see me through this process. As a new parent, I need you, God. As engaged, I need you. As newly married, I need you. As a graduate, I need you. I need you to guide my life. I don't know where I'm going, what I'm doing. I need guidance. God, I need you this morning because I'm getting ready to step into a field I've never done. I'm growing up. I'm getting older. I'm looking for where you want me to be. Not where I want to be, but where you want me to be. And God, I just need you this morning. Maybe this morning you just need to come and say, God, I surrender. I give it to you. And I want you just to guide me, to lead me, to help me, because God, I want to be used for your glory. This morning, while these are praying, if you need to come, why don't you come? Maybe you're struggling with something this morning. Maybe there's a struggle in your life. Maybe there's a need in your life, and you just want to come and kneel and give it to God. Faithful. He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. I'll be with you through it all. Amen. I'm going to get my ushers. You can be seated this morning. Let's take up our offering. And then the last thing I want to do this morning is honor our graduates, because I want you to be able to come back and congratulate them this morning as they stand up here at the front with their recognition certificates and gifts for those who graduate high school and college. And this morning, let's pray and bless our offering and ask God just to bless it. I ask you to give this morning as God has given to you, not because of necessity, but because of God's blessings on your life. Amen. And you want to see him just prosper you. Walk in faith this morning. Don't walk by sight. Don't walk by what you see. Walk in faith by God's word, and let the envelope do the talking for you. Amen. That God, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you to keep your word in Malachi 3:10. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you for the encouragement from the life of Joshua. I pray, dear Father, that you would bless every person here. God, take them to the place you have for them. God, use them in mighty ways, and wherever you lead them, whether it's in the home or the workforce, whether it's here in this county or in another county, God, whether it's around these people or other people, God, I pray wherever we go that you would be with us and that we could be strong and of good courage. God, I thank you that you have promises that you have spoken over our life before we ever existed. God, I pray you make come to pass every blessing and every promise you have for us. God, be with this offering. Bless it. Use it for the kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. While they're doing that, one last thing. Don't forget again that we are having youth next Sunday here at the church. I'll let you know the time. Also, number two, don't forget, if you're willing to help clean and be a part of the ministry in that way, please sign up on the cleaning sheet at the back of the church. And that way we can make sure the church stays nice looking, or the building, I should say, stays nice looking for us here at Transformation Church. All righty. So this morning we have about five that are going to be graduating or have already graduated. And so we want to recognize them this morning. And we appreciate you being here to help us do that. You know, the Bible says that when one of us rejoice, we should all rejoice. When one of us are sad, we should all be sad. I find it's easy to be sad with people, but a lot of times you don't find people rejoicing over the accomplishments. It's like the news. You turn on the news, you never hear nothing good. Amen. But I like to appreciate and acknowledge the achievements of our people. Amen. Because I remember it's not an easy thing to graduate. Amen. It's a tough thing. And so, is Bradley up there with you, Luke? He's where? Okay, come on down, Bradley. I'm going to start with Bradley. Bradley is graduating this year. He is going to be going from middle school to high school. And that's an achievement in itself anymore. Amen. And so we are wanting to give Bradley a certificate of recognition for doing that from the church. And so we are proud of you, Bradley, and we thank God for what he's doing in your life. Amen. And so we're going to just hang out with you, okay? And we thank God for that. And some of you may wonder why aren't you giving Bradley a gift, because I don't want to give it to him two or three times. Amen. So you'll get your gift if you accomplish the next 4 years. That's your goal. Amen. All right. And so this morning, as I call your name, please come up, and we want to honor you as well. Christian Almond, will you come up, please? Christian graduated from high school. So we're thankful for the accomplishment of Christian and the fact that I don't have to homeschool nobody no more. Amen. Math is a struggle. I was their least favorite teacher for the last 30 years. And here's a book. And the gift we're giving our kids this year is The Purpose-Driven Life for Graduates. And we're giving them that book because, you know us here, we believe that there's a purpose for your life. And we want them to know that there's a purpose for their life. So they're your gift. Amber Allman. Amber graduated respiratory therapy. Here at Baptist Hospital, she had God open a door for her that she didn't expect, and so she's had a change of plans and will be going to Baptist to be working with them. Lexi Carter. Lexi graduated high school. Year, and so I'm thankful for that and excited for her and Christian and where they're trying to go in their life. Carrie Kinney. Carrie graduated nursing school. She's already going into the workforce, and I'm excited for her as well. And then last but surely not least is Claudia Carricker. Claudia actually went to early college, so she graduated high school and early college. Amen. And so she kind of did two in one. And so we're excited and we're thankful. And before we let you come and we dismiss, I want to dismiss this morning by praying a prayer over these graduates' lives, that God will bless them. And I want you to help me in that, because the Bible says where two agree on earth, it'll be done in heaven. And I believe this morning that they could use our prayers. I remember how scary and how intimidating this point of life was. Not college, because I wasn't smart enough to go. But no, really, I just want to pray over them this morning and ask God to bless them. So will y'all join with me this morning where you're at, and let's pray over their life this morning that God will just help them and guide them. Father, this morning we've heard your word. Now we come to apply it. We come to remind you of your promises, oh God. Father, we thank you that you're faithful and that no words you've ever spoken will go undone, and that your word will never return to you void. Father, I thank you for every person standing in front of me that graduated from some level of education in this year. God, I pray this morning over their life. I pray right now your blessing and your favor over their life. I pray for your guidance. I pray, God, that every step they take, that we would be ordered by the Lord. God, I pray right now, Father, that you would open doors no man could shut and shut doors no man could open. I pray, Father, as you lead and guide and direct their paths, that it would be for your righteousness and your name's sake. And God, this morning, I pray that as they follow you by faith, sometimes not even seeing a step in front of them, that as they follow you and your word becomes a lamp unto their feet and a light unto their path, I pray you take them into every promise that you've decreed over their life before they were ever created. I pray, God, that you would take them into the promised land of their life, and that, God, as they go there, they would lead many into it with them.
God, that wherever they work, wherever they go to school, whatever they choose to follow you in life, and you've got them to, I pray it would be prosperous and successful. And God, I pray again for your blessing on them. I pray that you would take them to places and levels that they never dreamed was possible. Let them leave behind a legacy for the name of God. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Now, as we leave this morning, we're just done. I want you to come by and congratulate our graduates. If you have family here, you want to take pictures with them, feel free to do that today. But we are excited and we're thankful. Let's give God one more hand clap of praise and give them for their accomplishments. Amen. You're dismissed.